Richard Davis of the 13cubed channel is a great example for what I really love about YouTube. He's a professional in forensics and is kind enough to share his experience and knowledge in various videos about digital forensics and incident response. This is an industry and a topic that I have absolutely no clue about, and that's why I was really excited that he said yes when I asked him about creating a guest video for LiveOverflow. In this particular video, he will show how to use two different tools to acquire time series data of a system and then analyze it with a time series tool. And just by him talking about this, I also learned about prefetch files on Windows. I didn't know this is a thing. They are metadata files that are used to speed up application startups, and apparently they are super useful for forensics. Anyway, I hope you will enjoy this video and also check out his other videos on his channel.
Hello and welcome back to a special episode of 13cubed. In this video, we're going to take a look at creating a timeline, much as we did in Introduction to Plazo Heimdall within the Introduction to Windows Forensics series, only with a few key differences. In that video, we used log-to-timeline to create a super timeline, but did you know that we can also incorporate time-stamped artifacts from memory into these timelines? In fact, many memory artifacts that we have the capability to parse contain time-related information associated with them. This includes processes, network connections, and even registry keys and event logs that can be extracted from memory. In this episode, we're going to create a complete picture of all file system and memory-related events from a Windows 10 virtual machine, incorporating both traditional disk-based forensics as well as memory forensics. So we're going to cross the streams and combine content from both the Introduction to Windows Forensics and Introduction to Memory Forensics series. First, we'll use the Sleuthkit's FLS utility to create a file system timeline. Then, we'll use Volatility along with the Timeliner plugin to create a timeline body file. Next, we'll concatenate both datasets and use the Sleuthkit's MacTime parser to create CSV output for that data. Lastly, we'll take a look at the results using Eric Zimmerman's Timeline Explorer. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to do is run FLS without any options so we can see what's available. And as you can see, there are quite a few options for us to use. Very commonly, you'll see three used together. And those three are -R to recurse on directory entries, -D to display deleted entries only, and then -P to display the full path for each file. However, for our use case, it's going to be a slightly different set of options that we'll want to use. We will use -R to recurse, and then we'll use -M to display the output in MacTime input format. After the -M, we'll specify the arbitrary text that will serve as the mount point designator. In our case, it's going to be C colon, but we could literally specify any arbitrary string there. So we'll use FLS, -R, -M, C colon, and then we'll path to the file on the external drive to which I've connected, which is under Media, Davis RG, 13cubed, Disk, and then there's our EO1 file. We'll output that to fls.body. Now this is going to take quite a few minutes to run, so we'll come back when it's finished and then take a look at the results and move on to the next step. Okay, now FLS has completed and we have an fls.body file that has been created for our output. So let's go ahead and take a look at the first 50 lines of output for that body file. And as you can see, we see what looks like NTFS attributes and we see pipe delimited data, which looks to be valid data. So now let's go ahead and take a look at our next step. We'll clear the screen and we'll go ahead and run Volatility. We will specify the image file, which is again on the external drive. And I happen to already know that this is a Windows 10 image and I know the build number. If I did not, of course, I could run image info or the more capable KDBG scan to make sure I'm using the correct profile, which of course is very important with volatility, otherwise we'll get unpredictable results. So we'll specify Win10x64, 17134, the all-important timeliner plugin. We'll specify the output equals body, and then of course the output-file, which we'll simply put in the current directory and call timeliner.body. Now, just as with FLS, this will take several minutes to run, so we'll come back in just a few minutes when it's done and pick up where we left off. So again, we are now running the Timeliner plugin against the memory image taken from the same Windows 10 virtual machine. Now you'll notice a warning message which can be safely ignored, but it does seem that the Timeliner has completed successfully and we have our resulting timeliner.body file and our fls.body file. So as before, let's go ahead and take a look at some of the output from the Timeliner body file to make sure that it looks valid before we continue. So we'll look at the first 50 lines. And once again, we see pipe delimited data. I see PIDs and PPIDs available along with various process information. So it does look like the output is correct. So now let's go ahead and concatenate timeliner.body to greater thans and then fls.body. So we'll append the data to fls.body, which is now of course 577,000 lines long, and 22,000 of those are from the timeliner.body file. So now we have all of our data in one place. Our next step is going to be the generation of CSV output from those .body files. To do this, we're going to run MacTime. And as you can see, here are our available options. We're going to be using -z to specify the time zone from which the data was collected, and then -d to specify output in comma delimited format. Now, the -b also needs to be used to simply tell that we don't want to use standard input, but rather a body file as input. So we'll run MacTime, -z UTC, -d, -b, and then of course our fls.body file. We'll redirect that to timeline.csv, and this file will be the file that we'll look at in the final section of the video with Timeline Explorer. So let's let that run and come back when it's finished. And as you can see, just for a sample, I've opened this with LibreOffice Calc, and you can see that we have quite a bit of output here, so it looks like the timeline.csv file was successfully generated. And as I continue to scroll through here, you'll notice there is a massive amount of output. Now, we could use something like LibreOffice or Excel to perform our analysis, but as you'll see in the final section of the video, we're going to use a tool that's purpose-built for this called Timeline Explorer, and I think you'll see why it's better suited. So let's take a look at that in the final section of the video next. Back in the old days when creating timelines, we used the awesome Excel Timeline Color Template released by Sans, as shown in this screenshot. This template would color code various types of artifacts to make it much easier for the analyst to sift through massive amounts of timeline data to spot items of interest. While that's certainly still an option today, the easier way is to now use Timeline Explorer written by Eric Zimmerman. If you've watched other 13cubed videos, it will come as no surprise that I'm a big fan of Zimmerman's tools. If you're familiar with Registry Explorer or other software he's written, then you'll feel right at home using Timeline Explorer. And if not, don't worry. If you have even basic familiarity with Microsoft Excel, I think you'll find it to be a very easy to use and intuitive tool. Let's go ahead and switch over to it now. And the first thing we'll do is go to the Help menu and choose Legend. And as you can see, each of these colors represent a particular type of activity associated with items in the timeline. These colors match those used by the previously mentioned Sans template. So if you're already used to using that, then you'll feel right at home here. I'll also mention under Help, you'll find a Quick Help section that you may want to refer to, Much of what we'll cover in this section of the video is explained here, so just keep that in mind. Now let's go to the File menu and choose Open, and we'll choose our timeline.csv file that we created in the previous section of the video. This will take just a few moments to load. First, let me direct your attention to the blue status bar at the bottom. On the bottom left, we'll notice the full path and file name of the file that we've opened, and on the bottom right, we'll notice the total number of lines present within the file, as well as the total number of visible lines, which will change depending on the filtering options that we have applied. More on that shortly. Across the top, we'll see our column headers, including line, tag, timestamp, our file system MACB timestamps, meta, file name, and file size. Now, some of these are not going to be applicable depending on the type of artifact, but you'll note this when we scroll through the data. Immediately displayed on screen, you'll notice a bunch of things in red that are bracket, process, bracket. This, as you might assume, is data taken from our memory image processed by the Timeliner volatility plugin that we ran. This would normally not be present within just a normal FLS file system timeline. Here we see the file names for the processes, the process identifiers, the parent process identifiers, and some additional information. As we scroll through here, we'll also notice a threads section, which is listed as bracket thread bracket, which also includes PID and TID information for threads extracted from memory. You'll note that the processes themselves are in red, which means evidence of program execution, as we can see within the legend. Now, first, let me mention that when using Timeliner, it's not uncommon to see some invalid dates or missing dates. This plugin does its best to extract these time-stamped artifacts from memory, but I want you to remember that there is no money-back guarantee with memory forensics. By that, I mean that what you're looking for may or may not be present within a given memory image. The data you're searching for may have been paged out or otherwise corrupted, so just keep that in mind. Now, in the top left, you'll see a Find blink, which works exactly like you would expect. If I search for something such as svchost.exe and then press Enter or Return, the search will be executed, and we'll give it a few moments to return the results. And you'll see here that svchost.exe, the first occurrence of it, is right here. And if we continue to search, we'll notice that there are one of 10,523 references to this that were found. So again, the find blink is nothing special and works just like any other find blink in a normal application. We'll go ahead and close that out. Power filter is one of my favorite sections. This actually performs a logical OR. So here I'm going to enter three terms. First, we'll enter Richard, then 13cubed, then development. Now, I didn't have to press enter. As I started typing, the filter was immediately applied. And again, because this is a logical OR, not a logical AND, we're going to find any data that contains Richard or 13cubed or development. So you can immediately see on screen we have things like Richard's notebook.url. We have something called developmentplan.docx, and we can clearly see its file size and its location. We have link files, which are highlighted in a light green color showing evidence of file opening. We have information about a 13cubed_logo.png file, as well as what looks like an alternate data stream for the zone identifier, and various other information here. You'll notice in the bottom right, we have visible lines listed as 26. So 26 items have been shown after this filter has been applied. So again, this is an extremely powerful feature of the software, power filter. Let's go ahead and clear what's there. And this time, let's type in cmd.exe. And again, without pressing enter, this will automatically, after a few seconds, filter on cmd.exe. Now, we'll immediately note that we see things like nircmd.exe. So in other words, it doesn't have to be a complete match. It can be that cmd.exe was part of a file name. And we even see things listed in black here, such as sbecmd.exe, which according to our legend is evidence of file deletion. As we continue to scroll through here, we'll note that there are numerous other items here, including one in red, which seems to be a prefetch file. It's in red because it indicates program execution for cmd.exe, which of course, if you're familiar with prefetch, that makes complete sense. We see another entry in black, which is for something deleted. And then here we see memory-related information for cmd.exe in addition to our file system timeline information. So here we see two different PIDs visible, as well as the parent PIDs. We'll note the parent PID of 4748 is the same for both processes. And then, of course, the two PIDs are different. And then below, we see more file system artifacts for cmd.exe prefetch, which will show program execution. Now, if I wanted to clear the power filter, I could also go to the file name column and search for bracket process bracket. And when I do that, we'll of course see all of the processes extracted from memory. And you'll note that the earlier one was 4748 for our cmd.exe, which happens to be right here, and that's explorer.exe. So the parent process for that cmd was explorer.exe, which makes complete sense because it was launched from Windows Explorer. Now, obviously, we could spend quite a bit of time parsing this data as there are nearly 1 million lines of output. Let's go ahead and go back and clear the filter that we've applied by clicking the Clear Filter box. And then you'll notice on the bottom right, we have visible lines returned to the 956094 value. So nothing's being filtered. But I will quickly scroll through this data just to give you an idea of just how much we've been able to extract from the combined file system and memory timeline. You'll also note that by default, this is sorted by line, and it's attempting to display the information in chronological order. As I scroll up, you'll notice the dates on the timestamp column are going further back in time. I'll continue to scroll towards the top. And again, just a massive amount of information. And by the way, anything that was extracted from FLS that was a file system timeline event will of course have MACB timestamps present, as well as meta information for the NTFS file system. So just a massive amount of useful information. In and of itself, the FLS utility would already provide useful data, but of course, now that we have memory to go along with that, we can glean even more data from our investigations. Now, I could spend quite a bit of time looking through other things in this data set, but I hope this gives you an idea of the power of incorporating both of these types of data, as well as the power of Timeline Explorer to quickly analyze the data. So again, don't forget the column headers and the ability to filter on any of this information. Don't forget the ability to click underneath the column headers and simply search for something. And then, of course, we have our normal find blink, and my favorite, the power filter blink. If you mouse over the question mark as well, you can actually click it, and it will provide a power filter help that provides quite a bit of additional information and fancy searches you can do. As you can see here, we can exclude or include certain things, we can negate certain options, or stack query strings in different ways to get very granular with our search query, so I would definitely refer you to the Power Filter help to use the full ability of this software. But that wraps up what I wanted to show you in this video, and I certainly hope it's been helpful, not only seeing how Timeliner plugin works and how it can be combined with FLS, but also how Timeline Explorer works. And that wraps up everything that I wanted to cover here. As always, I want to thank you for watching. I hope you found the information informative and useful. And I'll catch you in the next episode.